Hey guys, we're back with our second video here on My Opinion Matters. We have the 2020 Mercedes A220. The 2020 A220. Well, let's see what this thing has to offer. This is the new Mercedes economy car, and I personally think they did a great job redesigning it for 2020. We have these great aggressive looking headlights. This wonderful new grille with intakes and such that just make it have a nice mean look, which is something that us car people really enjoy. We have some 5-spoke 18-inch wheels, which are a little bit of a pricey option, but I have to say they do look beautiful. Very nice looking, they fit the car nicely, especially this white color. So what we have coming around the back is an entirely redesigned rear end that we have not seen from Mercedes yet. If you look down the side, there's a little bit of C-Class in there. And on the front, you can see a little bit of the other, the CLS, what they just redesigned. But back here, this is something we have not seen yet, and it looks mean. Gives it a nice low sort of inward look that I really do enjoy. We actually have the sunroof open right now, which looks awesome. The way it slants all the way back here, it almost looks like a huge roof spoiler. It's very nice looking. I love large pieces of glass that open and close. It's a very, very nice look.
A220, 2020 A220 from Mercedes-Benz. I got my Benz hat on to show my Mercedes pride. We are fans of the Mercedes-Benz and the product they put out. And I gotta say, the A220 redesign, they nailed it. No disappointments. We went briefly around the outside of the A220. We're gonna make our way towards the inside. As you can see, both of the mirrors are folded in. You'll find that on almost every Mercedes model. You can simply look at your car and know that it's locked if your mirrors are folded in. The turn signal here is going to light up when I unlock it. Take a peek at that. Looks mean, looks menacing. You're also going to notice that you have your turn signal in the mirror here. When I hit the button, that lights up. That's obviously going to go off with the turn signal on as well. I'm 6 feet tall, weigh about 180 pounds. All right, maybe 220, but, you know, video, 180. Screwed that up. We'll cut that out. Can we cut that out? Sure. All right, so I'm gonna get this fine specimen of a 6 foot tall man into this 2020 A220. 6 feet tall.
Like a glove.
I fit in here nice. I've got room all around me. Let's take a peek at how the back seat looks. Again, I'm comfortable in the front seat at 6 feet tall, 220. When I first got in the back seat, I bumped my head right here.
Ouch.
And I remember this on the previous A classes as well. You do have to duck down if you have any height to you to get in the back seat. Again, I am comfortable with where the seat is up front. I can definitely go forward if I need to, but I am comfortable. My knees are touching the back of the seat here, but ultimately I'm in a good sitting position. I have plenty of room above my head. There's an armrest back here that comes down. If I shut this door, I still feel comfortable. I'm not overly cramped. I could spend a decent amount of time back here as a 6 foot tall individual.
Oh boy, that is a roomy trunk. Come check out how much stuff you can put in here. It's at least 2 suitcases. I mean, heck, if you want to put even more, you can just pull this latch and that latch, and look at this. Get the seatbelt out of the way, and voila. On this one, you can just do the same thing. Look at how much room that thing has. While we're back here at the trunk, I'd like to show something else. This is something very common in Mercedes. You can just pull up on this bottom piece here, and there's actually some extra storage. There's more so in their SUVs and such, but this is still a very helpful place. I personally would like to put all the manuals back here for the car and such, because I don't really think that they all should be in the glove box. I think it's a very brilliant idea, and that's my opinion on that subject.
Tag me in! Alright, this rocket ship is propelled down the road by this 2-liter inline 4 that produces 188 horsepower, 221 pound-feet of torque. And boy, let me tell you, it is enjoyable to drive. My opinion on it is you're going to be, you're going to be noticing the power off of the line and through the mid-range. It's fun. It's zippy. It'll put you and the passengers that are with you back in the seat. However, when it gets higher in the RPM range, it seems like it dies off a little bit, as well as under heavy acceleration, those shifts seem a little delayed. It is snappy right away off the line, and it's snappy after the delayed or lag when you're on a roll. However, it seems like a pretty darn good powertrain for this vehicle. If there is any exhaust note to be had by that beast of a motor that's under the bonnet, let's hear what it has to offer.
Experienced all of those furious 188 horsepower, let's check out what there is to offer in the interior. That's a very sturdy, nice feeling handle to close your door. It's on all four doors. It's very brilliant, very good idea. Now up here that we're in the interior, we got all sorts of technology. Right here we got the speedometer, tachometer, that sort of stuff, and this beautiful display that's very reactive, very quick. It's an OLED display, very high quality. Now up here we have all sorts of new technology that is just brilliant. We can control this beautiful ambient lighting across the whole interior. We'll insert a few clips of those right now. Guys, enjoyed that beautiful little light dance that the Mercedes put on for you. Now let's talk about more what the display can do. So we can control the display from right here. Just do nice little scrolls, sort of like a thumbprint or something on a phone. Or we can come onto the display and actually do it just like that. Very smooth. Or we can do it even from here. It actually gives a little vibrate when you do it from here. It's a very satisfying, clicky feel. Now let's go into the settings of the vehicle, sort of experience and see what it has to offer. We can come through here, we can look at all the different modes and stuff like that. You can see the sport and comfort and eco mode, which we can also control from right here with our dynamic button, and it'll show a fancy little picture of the mode that we're in, a very more aggressive or smooth feel based on how we're feeling. Now, let's see, we can change the steering as well, made it get sportier, and also the traction control, of course. Now, assistance, you got your brake assist, traffic sign assist, blind spot, attention. The attention assist is actually kind of cool in this car. It's something I haven't seen yet, but it's a very interesting idea. So rather than having like seat massagers, there's something where you can leave the seat into a position, and as you're driving on longer road trips, the seat will very so slightly move every once in a while just to sort of keep you awake, keep your muscles active, and not make you so sore, which is a very brilliant idea that I haven't seen yet. So now let's move on. The ambient lighting is right here. Here's some of the controls for it, of course. I know you guys saw what it looked like. Now here's the controls. We actually have over 64 different colors. So right here we have an entire color wheel of, we can change whatever we want it to be. There's also some preset ones with animations. You can have different colors on different parts in the vents, whatever. It's a very customizable, very cool thing. And then Mercedes is really, really pushing this feature where you actually talk to the car, and I have to admit, we hate it. We have been just having normal conversations, and all of a sudden Mercedes starts talking to us, and it is extremely annoying. You'll actually see that when we do our driving videos from earlier, our first reactions. Right here, Mercedes is thinking I'm talking to it, and you're supposed to say, hey Mercedes, and it's just, it can be very annoying.
As you can see, Austin covered a lot of the standard and some of the additional features that come with the A220. In this class of the entry-level European car, this is what we are expecting in today's market. The BMWs, the Audis, and the Mercedes, they are all building and delivering killer cars, killer interiors, awesome outside. It's kind of hard to put this in the category that the, what's the old saying? A poor man's Porsche or a poor man's Mercedes. It's hard to put this in that category with how well designed it is and how many options you get. I would not feel bad about driving this car. It is well designed. Like we said previously, in our first initial reaction video to the car, it's exciting to get in. I mean, if you have someone entering this car for the first time, it's kind of an exhilarating experience. Look at it. It's beautiful. It's awesome. My opinion is that chime's a little annoying, though. All right, so if you are still in the market for the A220 after seeing all the features and kind of the general design, let's take it for a spin to see if we cover anything that interests you. The stock on the side of the steering wheel is your gear shifter, just like a lot of different Mercedes models. Up is reverse, down is drive, the button on the end is park. You just simply tap it up, we'll go into reverse. You can see you got a reverse camera that turns with the car. We can go to a wide angle view. We can go back to the more pinpoint view, right? Nice clear picture. Mercedes rear view cameras seem to be about as high quality resolution as you can get. That'll stay on until you're at about 5 miles an hour and then it'll go off. Looks like the Mercedes wants to talk to us again, as it seems to always want to. But just the general feel of being in the captain's chair here, it feels good. I mean, the noises, the clicking, the buttons you hit, everything feels like good, high quality material. The way the steering wheel feels in your hand, it feels like you're behind something important. Something of a higher class or caliber. So Austin earlier briefly talked about some of the features throughout the car. There's obviously a lot more features than what we briefly touched on. If we went through and showed every dynamic, this would be an extremely long video, and I don't know that anyone would be watching at that point. It's kind of fun though. And it's very simple to scroll through items as you're driving the car. As you have the steering wheel controls, we have one on the left that's controlling your screen associated with the speedometer, and the one on the right, like Austin hit at earlier, that's controlling more of your infotainment, your climate, your navigation, all of those good things. And it always seems that Mercedes, at least a lot of the models I have been in, you have two or three different ways to do the same thing. Maybe that's if your significant other or passenger is driving, or your backseat driver who thinks they know better music and a better temperature than what you know, they can hit the buttons as well as you can safely do them while you're driving. But I think it's kind of fun that I can have the navigation right in front of me here. I can also put the navigation on this screen. I don't know, does that really mean you're an idiot if you get lost when you have two maps right in front of you? Not sure. So we've got two maps to look at. What are some other items we can have here? You can change the display. The whole display can change, as you can see. Obviously, there's a bunch of different items that you can scroll through, which I don't know how to do now. There we go. Just got to hit the back button. and we can change what's in the center there as far as your miles per gallon, your fuel, what mode you're in. And if I scroll over to the right, I can change and put all that same info over on the right.
Aggressive styling throughout the whole car. There's nothing to really complain about. I guess I had a few things badly to say about the seats. They were a little more comfortable as I went on. The new Mercedes. That's it. That's what I was thinking. That needs to get fixed. I don't know if it's an update. It's my only complaint on the entire car. Otherwise, it is beautiful, very well done, very nice new car. Todd, what do you got to say about that?
Yeah, if I was in the market for a smaller luxury sport sedan, this would be towards the top of my list. It might be at the top of my list. It's just a fun commuting car to drive. It's not spectacular. If anything, the interior is its high point. You know, and this is going everywhere from the mid 30 range all the way up into the $50,000 range. So if you were to completely spec one out, I could never imagine spending $50,000 on this car. But that might not be the case for you. This might be a perfect fit for you. If I had $35,000 to $40,000 and I was specifically looking for this class, this would be a winner for me. However, if I was just looking for a car that's in the $35,000 to $40,000 range, I might look elsewhere. That's just a personal preference and opinion for wanting maybe something a little more sporty, something a little more fun per se.
Great car, great value, lots of technology. Like and subscribe. Hope you guys enjoyed. Get ready for some more videos. Comment down below what kind of cars you want to see us review next. Comment below what you guys think of the new A2020.